Hey, thanks for coming out. I appreciate you. This talk is Transforming Security Through Design. My name is Wolfgang Goerlich. I am with Cisco Secure. And I'm going to be talking today about viewing security problems through the lens of design, through things like affordances, through things like sludge and nudge. I'm going to talk about how great it is when our end users violate policy and create exceptions, which you're not going to agree with me until maybe I get to that section, and maybe I'll win you over. We'll see. This talk began with the following statistic. I'm sure you guys have seen this, right? This is not an actual statistic, but I'm sure you've seen this. 90% of breaches are caused by people. 90% of breaches, 90% of attacks start because a user clicked a phishing link. 90% of clouds will be insecure by 2025, says analyst firm, because users. Right? We see this again and again. And so I had this number in the back of my head, and it's bothered me for many years. I've been in cybersecurity for too long. I stopped counting. I now would just say I started when the movie Hackers came out. That's easy enough for me to remember. And some people are like, oh yeah, I love that movie. And other people are like, I don't watch old films. The latter is the people you don't go out drinking with. Pro tip. So I had the stat in my head, and my wife gets me this book by Don Norman, Design of Everyday Things. I would argue you cannot do a design talk without talking about this design book. But my wife, my long-suffering wife, give her a moment of sympathy, gives me this book because I think she's tired of hearing me talk about cybersecurity and the people who are clicking and the people who are misconfiguring in the clouds and everything else. She gives this book. She's like, wouldn't it be great if you had like a hobby? Wouldn't it be great if you could talk about design? And it is great because now I'm really fun at parties. I'm like, did you know 1996, the Le Mans, Ford redesigned the brake system so it was one modular. Now, what that tells us with a modular system, if we did that with our SIM and our SOC, and my wife's just like, oh my God, what have I done? But, so, I see this book, and I read to this page. This is the exact quote from the book. Most industrial accidents are caused by human error. Estimates range from 75 to 90%. And I think that's great. It's not just me. It's not just me. It is health and safety. It is automotive safety. It's pilot error. Don Norman has a great section on power plants. And I swear I remembered every single time that my BCDR went off the rails and my trading system crashed and I got yelled at because the stock market moved. A little bit of trauma, but I got through it. So how is it so many people are incompetent? I'm like, thank you, wife, for this book. Thank you, Don Norman, for the answer. I eagerly flip to the next page and I'm confronted with the following quote. They aren't. It's a design problem. And so I'm like, click back, you know. Forward, did I miss a page? Did I miss a section? Do not tell me this, Don Norman. Do not tell me it's my fault. Do not tell me the reason my security programs don't work is because I haven't taken design into account. Do not tell me the reason why my users do not use my security programs is because they're hard to use. Do not tell me, Don Norman, that the reason my blue team got pwned by the red team was because our console was confusing. It was very confusing. It was a terrible thing. I love SIMs, I do. Horrible UI UX. Andy Ellis coined the term sucks for security user experience. Sucks, I love that. It's really resonated with me. So in this talk, I will attempt to summarize the past few years as I've been looking at this problem. I've been looking at design from a number of different ways. I've been spending times with architects. I've been spending times with car mechanics. I've been spending times with graphic designers. I've been spending, thankfully to my day job, times with product designers and product researchers who are like, here's how this works. Here's what users are doing. I mean, this is great stuff. So I'll attempt to summarize this and give you guys a framework and a lens of which to view security problems, which I have found helpful. Hopefully you will as well. It looks something like this. This is my model, right? Good or bad and different, this is how I look at things. What is the path that they're taking? What is the path our users are taking through our environment? What are they actually doing? What does that workflow look like? Why are they motivated to do it? And what are the choices that are making on that path? There's a number of different things that we can do to optimize this. We can say, hey, maybe we have too many steps, right? Maybe we can adjust the steps, maybe fewer, maybe make them a little bit easier. Maybe we can make them more familiar. I have a phrase I love, which is when work looks like work, work gets done. When something's familiar, people can do it, they can understand it, it gets processed, it gets completed. This works against us when it looks familiar and it's bad, as we see with phishing. Actually, by the way, I think that's behind why SMS phishing has taken off, if you think about it. If you got SMS phished like 10 years ago, you'd be like, what is going on? If you got SMS phished when I got started in the industry, it'd be like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you had to kind of figure out, oh, that's an A. I remember that character means, right? It wouldn't work. But then we spent 2020 training the entire American populace that text messages are good and meant to be clicked on. I got my food coming, I got text, that's great. My wife's like, hey, this is amazing, I've got this deal, I just need to click on this text message, right? I need groceries. I got a text message from my grocer saying, we cannot find your food. I'm like, I'm not surprised, find something else, it's all good. We convince everyone text messages are fine, and what happens? Almost immediately, it looks familiar, we start getting SMS spam. Work looks like work, work gets done for better or for ill. We can also reduce the friction of the stuff. So this one is where security people are obsessed. We've talked about this for a very long time, it feels like. We will get rid of the friction. I will argue later the friction is good, and again, maybe you can argue with me, or maybe I'll convince you. From a choices perspective, it's the number of choices. It is the predictability of each choice. How many times have you guys made a choice in a security console or in a web console, and you thought it would do one thing and it did the other, and then you're trying to undo it, and there is no undo button, and you're hoping no one notices, and you're like, oh, this is probably cool, this is dev, right? And they're like, no, that was prod. Not that we would admit to do that, because who has access to prod anyways, right? Okay, so predictability, and then the cognitive load, how much thinking we have to do. I'm sure it's come up multiple times in this conference. It comes up a lot, right? Thinking fast and slow, system one, system two. System one thinking is implicit, inherent, rote. The choices we make automatically. Where am I going to park? What direction do I need to turn when I'm driving to work? If I'm driving to work in a routine way, how do I reply to that email? That is what we're talking about here. System two, thoughtful, slow, costly. So this is effectively my model. Let's take a look at any one of the processes and just pick it apart. Now from that, we can go ahead and make certain decisions and choices to make things usable. We can map it out and figure out what's going on and what that looks like. We can apply some controls across that. Maybe we'll use a control framework. CSC seems grand. We'll try and reduce the steps and simplify and clarify. That's basically usability in a nutshell. One aspect of that is affordances. How do we get people to continue on that path? Affordances was coined by James Gibson. The idea is that the environment offers something to the individual, and the individual grabs a hold of it. We understand what it means, right? We understand what is allowed with this object. Textbook example of affordances is the door. The door on the left is a push. We know, we see that, we push, it works. The door on the right is a pull. Makes sense. The other image is an architectural studio I dragged my poor long-suffering wife to for a tour. Is that a push or a pull door? Right? It kind of looks like we should pull it, maybe. And so we walk up to it, my wife pulls it, it seems locked. We step back, we sit on a bench. Next person comes up, they pull it, they're not sure what they walk on. Third person comes up, they pull it, and then and push, and it's open, it's a push door. This is an architectural school where we're talking about affordances, and the classic affordance is the door, and that's what they have. Now, the correct answer is, that's stupid, right? The security answer is, it is a pull door, just from the other way. We'll fix that in a new release, don't worry about it. It'll be fine. There are several affordances to think about. And what's fascinating about this is you can map affordances pretty nicely to the needs of the people who are following this path, the needs that we need to consider of the people we serve and the people we protect. There are functional affordances. This is that door, right? Form follows function. In security, a classic example of functional affordances is my IAM role. Identity Access Management, I come to the company, I am a call center, I'm put in the call center role, I can do everything a call center person can do. I'm in finance, I put in the finance role, I can do everything a finance person can do. In security, I'm put in the security role. We do not get admin access. You guys laughed earlier like you're in prod. Don't do that. Just don't admit to it. Emotional function of affordances are also interesting. What's the best way to get people to do multi-factor? Get them to dance. There was a game that gave players an emote that allowed their characters to do dance routines if they enabled MFA. Awesome. Awesome. I mean, I want every time a user to do a security control, they do a little dance. That is fantastic. When I was originally interviewing at Dual Security, I interviewed with the VP of product, and we were having this little conversation. I wasn't quite this, but I'm like, affordances? He's like, yes, emotional affordances. I'm like, yes. He goes, do you know how much time we spent in the smiley and frowny faces? I'm like, I want to know the story. And they spent time looking like, this frowny face really makes you feel terrible, and this one makes you feel shamed, and this one's like, I'm not going to answer that, and figure out like the exact right emotional coordinates to hit with an emoji to get you to update your device. Affordances, emotional affordances, fantastic. Cognitive affordances is, you know, it works like everything we know. Like I say, computers look like computers do. Tablets work like tablets do. I have menu system, I have things I can click. It works like we expect. Cognitive affordances, very good for new users. I walk into an environment, and I automatically am presented with a set of commands, and I understand what those commands mean. I click on things, and things happen. It's exciting. Physical affordances, complete opposite. Like, system one thinking is all about the physical affordances, my muscle memory. I'm gonna click something, I'm gonna do something, things are gonna happen. This is for power users. I had a SOC analyst one time, and this guy was amazing. What he did was he had a gaming mouse, and so he took this gaming mouse, which had like 64 buttons on it, and he wired each button to a different series of commands that he sent to his computer. Phishing ticket, that button. All of a sudden, windows are popping up and things are copying and pasting, boom, done. This button, investigate, two. This gun, copy, paste, send it off to level two, done. I'm like, how much time should you spend doing this? He said, probably too much, but we looked at his numbers, like he was able to process a ticket like no one's business. It was amazing, amazing stuff. Sensory affordances, things like, hey, is the colors visible, right? We don't think about color blindness very often, those sort of things. What's really intriguing about this is if you think about this entire map and go, what does security actually care about? Probably not much about the end users, mostly what's functional, mostly what's offered, and mostly what we expect from a cognitive perspective. We don't think about many of these at all. And then when security doesn't happen, we wonder what went wrong. This also provides a really good lens. Like, all right, people writing down passwords. Bad, good, we all can agree that pretty bad, right? Please don't do that, don't put it on sticky notes. I saw a study that there's like 190 passwords per person in the workforce these days, which is awesome. I want a wall of sticky notes. This is my 2022 fall plan. But think about this for a minute. If the affordance of the mouse for the SOC guy was to solve that cognitive problem, the affordance for writing passwords down is the fact that we haven't provided a way to do that, right? We haven't solved that cognitive need. It suddenly makes much more sense why people are doing what they're doing. So we can start to troubleshoot some of the behaviors that we see from that space. Fundamentally, if we don't meet their needs, they're going to work around it. They're going to use a mouse, they're going to write things down, they're going to go off, and they're going to create their affordances to solve those needs themselves. And the more constrained we make the environment, the more controls we put on them, the more creative they're actually going to become, which is one of my first insights. Creative users are incredibly dangerous, right? You have not met my needs, therefore I will meet my needs, and your controls are onerous, therefore I will do what I need to do. And it's never something we want to do, right? It's never good for the security of the environment. One example of this was the time I caused a breach. I say that like there's probably only one time. No, what happened was I was doing an assessment, and we're collecting data for an audit. And I had a team of auditors out there, and we were all given physical MFA tokens. So, you know, that's the clunky things we're carrying around. And they're like, all right, so you need to log into the VPN, but the VPN's old, so I got to give you instruction about it. I'm like, all right, what do I do? And they're like, okay, so you download this client, which, by the way, broke our VPN to like every other client. Automatically, that's fun. You download the client, you put in your username and password. Okay, I got that. I know that one. Like now, you put in, it's going to say denied, so you put in your username and password plus the MFA code. Now, for those of you paying attention and thinking about password hashing, what does it tell you that you can put in the password plus the MFA code and they still are able to log you in? someone's not hashing. Something's clear text. And like, oh, by the way, after that, it'll either work or you'll get a login prompt, in which case, just start over. Predictability of choices? No, no, no. Okay, so we're going to do all that. Now I'm on my VPN. I'm good. All right, now execute a net use command to the file server, and what? Is this 1993? Yes, and by the way, that's a shared account for your company. What? So now we're mapping network drives to these files. Now, anyone try to use the Wi-Fi in the hotel before RSA the past couple days? I could not. I tried to get on video calls. I ended up calling in with the phone. Imagine doing Windows file share for audit evidence with no version control for audit evidence. It was really, really bad. And so my consultant team, my crack consultant team was like, this will not stand. Wolf will not have patience for this. I know what we'll do. We'll use our SharePoint. Like, because it's got MFA. Yeah, absolutely, push MFA. It's got individual users, yes. Non-repudiation is good for audit evidence, yes. It's got version history. Woo, we're on a roll. And that's how I found myself sitting with the CISO, showing our evidence and talking about this. And she goes, where are you getting that from? I'm like, our SharePoint. She goes, you realize you guys signed an agreement that no data would leave company property, and you've effectively caused a security breach. Like, yes. But in my defense, we were creative. We were creative. All right, let's talk a little bit about feedback. In PDCA terms, right, design is the plan, right? Security operations, the do, metrics, retrospectives, the process, that iteration is the check and adjust. So if you're doing PDCA, you are here. One of the interesting things about the choice aspect is a thing called choice architecture, popularized and well studied by Richard Thaler, who called this nudge, right? A nudge is the alternative to rules and mandates. If the tight rules and mandates cause people to be too constrained and therefore too creative, we'll nudge them along the path gracefully and gratefully, allowing them to make the correct choices, often with good default choices to keep people in system one thinking, to make it routine and make it good habit. So that's what a nudge is. A nudge is, if you think about that path that people are going to do, a series of small little prompts to keep people on the path doing the secure behavior in a good way. The opposite of that is sludge. Sludge is when people face high levels of friction that effectively obstruct their efforts to get their work done. Nudge gets them to the end, sludge obstructs them. Thaler says sludge is friction and bad intentions. I'm going to argue with both of those points. Thaler's probably right, but I'm on stage. So, first off, we're all in RSA. We're all security professionals. I would like to think we can agree that when we get in our user's way and we make their lives terrible, it's not necessarily bad intention. It may be thoughtless, possibly, but we're usually pretty good intention. Like, we're doing this for a reason, right? We're trying to do this for your own good. And Thaler actually talks about, like, we do this for your own good. Yeah, but that's why we need nudges. But I do think we have generally good intention. Now, friction is really interesting. I'll come back to friction in a moment. So we need to look at the paths that they take. Through process analysis, journey mapping, behavior mapping, we need to look at wayfinding. Wayfinding is cool. I never understood how cool wayfinding was. I'm at the San Diego Zoo. I was telling you about this earlier. I'm at the San Diego Zoo. I'm like, this wayfinding is awesome. And my wife's like, can we just see like the penguins? I'm like, no, I need to ask our tour guide about the elevators and the wayfinding. Again, I'm fun, I swear. But my poor wife. Wayfinding is our ability to find our way in systems or in life. It's really impactful when we're trying to make sure that people can find our way through our security controls. People can be in a ship in the middle of the ocean if they've grown up there and find their own way. This is like the Moana rule of cybersecurity. And yes, I absolutely have looked at Moana as a lesson of cybersecurity. So you can find your own way in a canoe just looking at the water. If you are of the northern clime, you can be in a snowstorm and you can find your own way with what would look to me like nothing but whiteness. That's what you can do in the north, that's what you can do in a canoe. It's even true that you can put a CISO on the floor of RSA and they can find their way in the vendor area all the way to the zero trust XDR stack. We're really good at that. Seriously though, we're really good at finding our way. But we do need to think about it in terms of the journey to help people along the way. I've sat with research teams who are like, yeah, we did a study and they were excellent. We did another study, we're excellent. We did another study and the wayfinding was off the charts. We did a third study and I thought, wait a minute, what if we didn't tell them where to start? And suddenly the task completion went to zero, right? Because we do need to think through how do people get on that path and find their way through it. And then we need to look at what the path looks like through their eyes. Is it something that is absolutely trash because it's hard and complicated, the choices are difficult? How can we evaluate that and pull lessons learned? And if the expected path works, is their system one thinking? Is that our system one thinking? Is it belong in security, right? I would almost argue system one versus system two thinking organizationally means system one thinking, what's known, what's expected, what's operational, what's routine, belongs with IT, right? It's IT operations. This is what they're good at, provide consistency. System two, where you gotta stop and think about, is where security is good at. Let us handle the exceptions. So, bad friction, right? Bad friction is invisible to security teams. Bad friction is sludge. Bad friction encourages people to break rules and work around the controls. Bad friction looks like this. I'm driving along and there's rumble strips. Or if you're in Michigan, I'm driving along. Period. Ah, my God, Michigan roads. So, but think about this exact same control paradigm and move it over a little bit, right? If you got a road and you have a rumble strip on the next side of the road, how cool is that? 99% of the time, system one, I'm driving along, I don't even know about it, it is great. The 1% of the time I start to fall asleep on the wheel or turn to my wife and start telling her a story and forget I'm driving, it's awesome to remind you and prevent a car crash, right? Friction can be really good. Good friction is a natural consequence of poor security behaviors. I was helping an organization and we're designing their identity and access management program. And they're like, Wolf, here's my problem. My application owners are absolutely sick of having to configure everything manually. And my business owners are like, I've got this whole catalog of things that are confusing. And my application owners and business owners will not engage with my IGA program to help build out what role engineering should look like and do all that. So how do I make it easier for my app owners and my business owners? I'm like, maybe you don't. Maybe you use that friction to naturally get them to the table and then provide a better experience and a better path in the back way. Maybe you keep that a little bit of friction so that they know they're off the path. And maybe that's okay, maybe that we do need to do stuff manually, but so they know they're off the path and are encouraged to do things properly. Good friction provides natural consequences. All right, problems along the way. There's really two main problems with this when it comes to friction and feedback. Metrics and feedback cycles. We'll talk about metrics first, and then I'll get to feedback cycles, which are so long, oftentimes we don't even know where the friction is. But for metrics, our metrics are like this, right? What can we count, and how can I take a percentage, and if I can average it, I'm really doing math now, this is science. It's our metrics, right? Oftentimes, that metrics obscures all the friction, all the tension, everything behind the scenes. There's a great way of doing metrics called HART, if you guys haven't seen this. This came out of Google. It basically looks at things like the happiness of the user, the engagement of the user, and task success. I think we could apply those HART concepts to a lot of things like onboarding folks, an IAM example, getting on remote access, and the example I shared earlier, those types of concepts. So we need to measure compliance rates, but we also need to measure any sludge and along the process and communication sides. So, as a good example for this, using the HART framework, I've got a friend who's a CISO in banking, and he uses this framework to look at all the steps that people are taking along the way. And he's assigned friction scores, like MFA is one, and step up authentication is two, and if I gotta switch accounts, that's three, and he adds all those up and tracks that friction. Now you say, okay, this makes sense, right? Okay, we got some good visibility. What about the adversarial side? Banking, great for fraud. Sounds bad when I put it that way. Let me say that differently. Banking, really good because we know what bad looks like. It's quantifiable, it's more understandable. So now we've got the friction, now we've got the fraud. And you're probably thinking, oh, this is awesome. He sits down and says, you got lots of fraud, take more friction. That's what most of us do in security. But he actually does the opposite. When he sees fraud rates fall, he meets the business unit and goes, here's my plan to reduce your control environment and reduce friction on your end users. Really interesting, right? How often do we pull out old controls that aren't needed? How often do we stop doing things that we've done for 20 years, but is still on the PCI DSS, so we must still be doing it? We don't oftentimes do that. And you better believe, because he takes that approach, when he does go to the business unit and goes, all right, look, your fraud's in an uptick. They're like, all right, what do we need to do? Let's do it, right? Because he's more bought into the process. Okay, let's talk about exception handling. People break the rules, people violate processes, people opt out because of poorly designed processes, right? Policy violation and exception handling is really useful in this endeavor. And yet, we oftentimes don't think about it. I'm gonna deploy a PAM system, awesome, do it. And I'm gonna vault passwords, yes you should. And it occurs to me, no one should even log into service accounts. Yeah, why are people logging into service accounts? That shouldn't happen. And I'm gonna rotate them on a regular basis. Well, yeah, I mean, how often have we had a service account that's been in the environment for 5 years and is still in use, but we find out it's actually in use by an admin who's using it as a backdoor, right? Those crazy things. Makes sense. What's your exception handling process? For what? I'm like, well, for maybe services that do need to log interactively. For troubleshooting. What about exception processes for services that can't restart because my trading system back in the day, I was a CISO in financial services, was terrible. I had to reset the password over here and take that down, and then reset 4 services in the middle tier and take those down, and then rotate the database, and then take up 1 service over here, and then rotate the database again, and it was just a nightmare, right? What about exceptions like that? Oftentimes, we don't think about exception handling until too late and it's in production. I think exception handling is effectively the way that users are communicating to us. And we can imagine a path like this, right? This system one thinking, awesome, IT operations opportunity right here, nice clean paid path. Let's let them do that. But everyone else is going off in the sideway. Maybe that's what we need to spend time with. Maybe that's who we need to talk with. Maybe that's what the security team needs to focus in on to figure out what we're missing. Does it need to be paved? Do we need some signage? Do we need some better wayfinding? What is it that's missing? So we want to look at this as a way of getting feedback on our controls, a way of getting feedback on our design. And when we get this feedback, we want to bucket it up. Like, what does this feedback mean to me? What's going on? What are the different ways? Not just, oh, they didn't know what they're doing. What are the different ways that things can go wrong? This is one of my favorite tools for this. This comes from learning behavior changes that fail. And they bucket it up into 8 different categories. I'm not going to go through them all. But you can look at certain things like, hey, something else happened and we were breached. The environment didn't support what we asked them to do. Those sort of things. Specifically in security, we usually only focus in on the first couple. Like it didn't work, or it backfired, or they did something else afterwards. Because they weren't sure what they were supposed to do, or because they weren't sure why they were supposed to do it. One of my favorite examples of this, back to the financial services firm, was I had a great network. I loved my network. Me and my network are friends. Low malware, low incidents, other than when I was causing them. But one day we had like our console just lit up, right? All these alerts that malware is scanning over the network, all these problems. We jump into action, we figure out what it was, we trace it down to a laptop in one of our executives' offices, a laptop in one of our executives' offices that did not have NAC. Why? Because he figured people were coming in, so he needed some flexibility, so he needed an open port. Of course, you're an executive, you get that. I came in, I'm like, how's it going? What's going on? He's like, oh, my kid's laptop is infected. He brought his kid's gamer laptop. I was like, bring your kid's infected laptop to work day, apparently. And I didn't get that memo, or my SOC team would have been prepared. He brings his laptop in. I'm like, what? Okay. All right, now I understand what's going on. why did you do this? And I will never forget what he told me. It stuck with me to this day. He looked me dead in the eyes and he goes, Wolf, where else would I bring it? This is the most secure place I know. Like, okay, thank you. Tell the board that. Unplug that damn thing. We're going to give you some other options. So a lot of it, at the end of the day, comes down to good exception handling. I was working with an international firm. I was working with specifically the North America's headquarters. And they had this IAM process. Now, we've argued for years, people, process, and technology. What is more important? How do these things go together? It's still not entirely clear. Scientia, Wendy Nather talked about this with the Scientia data and the security outcome study, that they've looked at it, and like if you have, you know, your people and process and technology, you have 3x multiplier of performance. But if you have two, if you have like people and process, you have a 2x multiplier of performance over other security teams. So you got good people process, you have a good shot. And I loved what this team did because what they didn't have good technology, right? I mean, they had okay tech, but it wasn't a tech program. It was an exception handling IAM program. They had great people and they had a great process and they spent most of their time going, how many people did not onboard correctly? Let's go meet with those business units and figure out how we didn't serve them right this time. Oh, you've got a contractor and the contractor didn't allow for that? Let's put that in procurement. How many applications didn't onboard correctly within this period? Oh, I noticed this team put on three applications. Let's go meet with that team. Oh, you didn't know that there's a process and it wasn't clear to you? Let me address the cognitive affordances and make the documentation, the process more clear. That was what they did for 3 years before they invested in tooling. 3 years, awesome program. Incredibly tailored, incredibly personalized to the institution, and incredibly good at reducing the risk. So exceptions are fantastic. All right, let's talk about how to use this from a culture change perspective. I've been talking about the users, and we all know the users, right? We all like to blame the users. But there's also the customers. The banking CISO I mentioned, right, his whole program was actually thinking about the end users, the customer, what path are they using to open accounts, transact, close accounts, those sort of things. There's also our coders. What are we doing to make sure our coders know how to write good code and clean code? Affordances have given me such a good lens at this. A long time ago, I had a dev team, and the dev team would write apps, and we put the apps into production, and we would pen test the apps. And the pen test report would come back and go, there's a session management and a credential management problem with this app. And I would hand that to the dev team, and the dev team would fix it. And then we would have another app, and we had the same finding, and I'd hand it to them, and they'd fix it. We'd have another app. So finally, this happened a few times, and I'm at my wit's end. I am absolutely at my wit's end. I'm like, how many times? So I had it on the screen. I called the heads in. We're sitting in the conference room. I'm like, do you know what this is? Right? I was like, what? Ugh. And they're like, yeah, of course we do. I'm like, you should. Good, good. What is it? And they're like, oh, yeah, is that from our knowledge base? I'm like, run that by me again real slow? They're like, yeah, I think that's our wiki page on how to build new apps, right? Their entire process was copy vulnerable code, build vulnerable package, push vulnerable package to production, wait till Wolf yells, fix vulnerable package. Great workflow. From an affordance lens, what is that? What is the problem there? Well, the path they take, how can we inject in that path? Well, clearly, we fixed the code on the website, and now everything else is good. It wasn't good. There's lots of other things to find. But now my pen testers are finding good at fun things, not the things we found many times over. DevOps side. I'll come back to my DevOps story in a minute, because it makes me cry, and I don't want to talk about it here. The cloud engineers, right? Again, major analyst firm has predicted by 2025 that 90% of all breaches will be because of cloud engineers. So what do, right? We use our wayfinding skills to find the cloud posture security manager, and we set up a scan of all our environments so we can catch them. But how oftentimes is that from the templates they're using and the way they're building and the way that by textbook cloud instances should be deployed? Our privileged access users, I love me some privileged access users. Let me show you the way by giving you a privileged access workstation and making you log in through a session broker and get all your creds that way. until you want to kill me because I'm having you do that. I will tell you one fun thing about that. One time I did succeed at a PAM program, we gave everyone Alien Vault gamer laptops as their privileged access workstations. That was the most security Blue Neon has ever bought me. They were so excited about those. I'm like, yes, these are yours. Please log into CyberArk now. And then, of course, networking engineers, right? That knack comment I mentioned earlier with my executive was on purpose, but I've definitely had times where I was working with like a hospital system, and they're like, we've got knack on all our devices. I'm like, that's awesome. I send out my team to check it, and on like one out of every five, there's no knack, and we can do whatever we want. Consistently is hard for people. So how do we get around this? Security champions, you guys all know it's easy. You have someone in the networking team that's a security champion. You've got a developer who speaks for security. You've got someone who's embedded in the DevOps function who says, wait, don't click prod push. We must secure that, right? And goes running and intersects. This is what we do. What people don't talk about is security advocacy. So if a security champion's role is to champion security within the business function, I would argue we need a security advocate role within security whose role it is to champion the business function for the security function. Do you really want our developers logging everything through PAM? Yes, we do. All right, please talk to our advocate who's going to explain to you the sludge and the security fatigue associated with that. And then we can decide. Maybe that's a great call, but then we can decide. So if you think about it, between the security subject matter experts and the business, we want the advocate and champion partnering together so that we've got two-way communication. The advocate is ensuring that we're handling friction and whatnot within the security function, not asking too much. This is my insight here, is that a good security advocate program, unlike how many of us think about them, is not meant to push out things we've already decided on high from the security function, unless you heard them from RSA and Stage, in which case they're pretty good, given to these champions. It rather is to provide two-way communication to make sure we're deciding the right things. Okay, my DevOps story. All right, so I built early-stage DevOps with Azure, hybrid environment before we were calling it hybrid, private cloud before we really should have called it private, about a decade ago. And this was early days DevOps, when it was all about culture, not much about tools. We walked uphill both ways to the data center. We churned our own butter. It was a good time. Many years later, I was asked to come in and consult with a SaaS company, and they said, hey, we want you to help get our code and our infrastructure and everything correct. And we do infrastructure as a code, and we've got all the controls in place to make sure that our developers are not doing any you know, pet work, right, cat on pets, that they're really, truly using infrastructure as code. Like, this sounds cool. Like, I wanted to do this 10 years ago. I can't wait to meet them. So we all get in a room, and I'm excited, because I've heard about CI/CD pipeline. I say, tell me about your CI/CD pipeline. And there's a long pause. And I think maybe that's not the wrong term. Is it CI/CD or is it CD/CI? Oh, no. And they're like, well, which one? I'm like, well, the prod one. There's another long pause. And that's when it occurred to me. I'm like, well, let's start over. How many pipelines do you have? You guys want to guess how many pipelines they had? Hundreds. Because there's too much friction to administrate a server. So if they had to make a change of a server, they just created a new pipeline, which was easy for them to do. And then they had a pipeline for this and a pipeline for that. And oh, by the way, the sudoer file keeps getting messed up, so we created a new pipeline for that. So many pipelines. If we do not create affordances in our environment, our DevOps people will create their own affordances. Creatively, dangerously. Okay, I'm running out of time. I got 10 more minutes or so. So I want to talk about the opposite side of this, the defend side. I call this my four abilities when I'm doing security architecture. There's the usability side, which we've really been focusing on. How do we make this usable? And again, it's not just for the end user, it's for the customer and DevOps and everything. But also defensibility, which we're going to cover next. How do we make sure that we use this exact same framework to stop the adversaries from getting in? That's what I'm going to cover. Manageability. How hard is it to run these tools? Does it take me 6 months, 8 months, 2 years, 3 years to deploy a control, in which case the entire risk environment has moved? or is it easy to spin up? Do I need to add headcount, in which case it probably won't get approved, or is it easy to do? And auditability, is it traceable? Is it manageable? These exact same processes, but for gathering evidence, for answering the obligations for internal and external audit, and from our regulators. The four abilities. There's actually a fifth one, which is way out of scope, but is, can I even sell this to the business? Like, is this marketable? We're not covering that here. That's hours of talk. But on the defensibility side, think about this for a minute. This is the exact same path. Paths they take in our environments to defraud us. Choices they're making along that. How can we increase the number of steps? How many steps? No clue. However, Verizon Data Breach Report finds it's around 15. If it's 15 or more steps, the success rate from an attacker drops significantly. First to 50% or lower, and then all the way down to zero. Increasing the number of steps can completely derail an attack. Familiarity with each step. Oh, it's simple. I just run Bloodhound. Wait a minute, they're micro-segmented and they've got a red forest. Game over, red team, take that. They'll probably still get me, it's okay. Friction, of course, the number of choices. How can we increase the number of choices that they need to make? Decrease the predictability so they're not really sure what's going to go on. This is all about deception. We can have an entire conversation on just deception at this point in time. And how much thinking are we going to have them do? How much can we pull them out of that system one thinking and into system two? Why? Because system two is expensive, system two is hard. Generally, if you've got 10 things you're doing, you want 9 of them in system one, 1 in system two. If it's 2 or 3, you're very frustrated and you're very annoyed and you're probably going to task quit. So we take that exact same model and we apply it to the defensive side. Using an attack path or threat model, right? Using something like MITRE ATT&CK, and we look for ways to complicate and compound. Now, what's fascinating about this is if you take the map of what the users are doing, and you take an attack path of what the adversaries are doing, those are two different paths. There's interceptions, but there's two different paths. And by looking at it through that lens, suddenly you realize there's a whole bunch of controls you can put on the adversary path that the users don't even see, right? Oh, we're concerned about phone fraud? Well, maybe we only allow them to register a certain number of calls, right? Oh, we're concerned about this particular attack. Amazon's one of my favorites. Oh, we're concerned about people buying stuff with stolen cards and stolen accounts and shipping to someone else? Maybe we'll only get in the way if we're shipping to a new address we haven't seen. There's a lot of attacks that we can do that actually frustrate the adversaries but are completely invisible to the end users. One of my favorite stories about this, I was working with a totally different SaaS company that had the appropriate number of DevOps pipelines, I'll have you know. And we were helping them get ready for a pen test, harden the environment, put in place good governance. Our pen tester comes in, he started on like Wednesday, he figured he'd be done by Friday. He ends up working late, he ends up working the weekend, he ends up throwing the towel in several days into the following week. And I'm feeling good. I don't know about you guys, but I'm feeling real good. So I sit down with the team, and I'm like, this is great. All that work we've done, look, it paid off. This is awesome, right? Don't you feel good? I feel good. Like, yeah, Wolf, about that. Like, all right, what did you tell me? Like, well, your pen testers are going to start with, like, scanning our website and using automated tools, which create a whole bunch of 404s, right, page not found, a whole bunch of 500s, SQL Server error, especially if doing SQL injection. So we've set it up so that if we get too many of those in a 5-minute window, we lock that IP address for 10 minutes. I'm like, okay. He goes, yeah, what's cool about that is if it's a user, they're like, oh, that's weird. The internet is weird. And then they get on Reddit and they get on Twitter and they go get a cup of coffee and everything's working again. If a user is even going to try and open pages that don't exist. If it's an adversary, that's just long enough for their tools to time out and for things to break and then everything to come back up and completely confuse the red teamer. Awesome. Isn't that awesome, right? Right along the path that they're taking, every step of the way getting in their way. So defense can be incredibly strong with this. All right, some final thoughts with our time together. I have been working on this and thinking about this for a while. If you want to follow up with me, I'll be happy to talk about it. I would love to help advise, coach, and architect any of your programs. I'm not going to do all the Visios and everything. I mean, like, if you want to run something by me, I would love to have that conversation. Me personally, not me, Cisco. I really find this intriguing. I think there's a lot here that explains security behaviors that for decades we haven't been able to explain. So what can we do with this? Before we're doing a security architecture, use some of this in action. Go ahead and map out how people are going to work. Go ahead and do the attack map. Look for the overlaps. Look for controls that don't overlap. If you are having an active security initiative, use this. IAM is fantastic for this. How can I make affordances within my IAM roles? How can I have appropriate friction where it matters and reduce friction for where it doesn't and add automation? If you've got an existing system that isn't working, and we all do, this also can be a good vehicle to do troubleshooting. So I'd encourage you to grab these slides and use this as a way to sort of get to the root of what is broken. In the next several weeks, in the beginning, start with usability and defensibility like I did here. Map it out. Evaluate the controls. Put in place metrics, and not metrics we can count, but metrics that get to the heart of whether or not, using heart metrics or not, I did not mean to do that, but this is funny. Using metrics that get to the heart of whether or not people are satisfied and making appropriate choices and taking appropriate steps. Within 6 months, map out manageability and audit. How much is it taking to manage this? What's the path they're taking, the choices they're taking? How are we going to audit and support this? And start establishing those control feedback loops. Making sure we're spending most of our time, our very valuable, thoughtful, curious, expensive time on the exceptions so that we can better tune our control environment to what people really need, what people really think, and how people really act. That's it for me. Thank you very much, everyone.